Welcome to this presentation on what the CEO and the board want in their next CFO. This presentation is going to discuss 10 skills that differentiate top financial executives from their peers. My name is Blair Cook. Now, a bit about me. I retired from being a CFO in 2009. In my last role, I had the joyous experience of being CFO of Clark Inc., a publicly traded investment company during the 2008-2009 Great Recession. I saw my share price plummet by 75% in 6 months. I moved on from that executive role to work at the board level for a number of Clark investees, as well as rejoining the Clark board itself in 2012. So there's been a bit of a redemption, as you can see. The Clark share price has rebounded nicely in the 6 years since. I really enjoy fulfilling the role of corporate director, as it gives me the broadest possible perspective of each of the businesses I'm involved with. But I've always had a development slant throughout my career. I've been actively involved in post-secondary education, professional certification, and executive development for the better part of 2 decades. Of particular interest to me has been developing and defining the career path from finance professional to the executive office of the CFO. This is a depiction of my business philosophy and how I form my views on both professional education as well as the advisory services I provide to the companies I serve. It's a model that is designed to generate, test, challenge, and share ideas, what I've referred to as applied practice. It turns out that not everything we've learned about in textbooks gets practiced in the real world. And shocker, in the same way, I've come across many ideas that I've observed and tried in practice that aren't mentioned in any textbooks. So today's session is an example of what I called applied practice in action. I recently attended an FEI conference that had a panel discussion with a few of Canada's most prominent CFOs. One question posed to a member of the panel was, how did you come to be picked as the CFO out of all the other candidates? Now, it's a good question and one that is highly relevant, whether or not you are someone aspiring for the office of the CFO or you are a CFO looking to become more successful at your own or another organization. Isn't that what we all really want to know? Our university programs and professional designations do a wonderful job of training us in various fields of finance, accounting, treasury, risk management, and the like. But does that really make us ready to become CFO? Of course not. Experience is certainly a component that helps us develop competency. That is, the ability to do something which is beyond the knowing. But what else sets top financial executives apart from their peers and ultimately gets them hired in this important role? The moderator directed the question to Alistair Cohen, CFO of Suncor Energy, a $50 billion company and the 7th largest integrated oil company in North America. Mr. Cohen is a many times CFO, but was still relatively new in his role as CFO at Suncor. So as I sat there listening to Mr. Cohen's response, I thought to myself, this would make for a really good presentation topic. Let's listen to his response.
It's table stakes that you understand and you're competent in your the basic financial stuff around reporting, controls, accounting, treasury, operations. I mean, that just gets you to the table. And if you don't have that, you're not going to get there. I think that there's two or three things that were particularly key. One was a business understanding. They want somebody who understands the business. They don't want a numbers guy. You know, I mean, there's people in the organization who do that, but they want somebody who can be sit at the table, talk about numbers from a business perspective, how they're impacting it, the trends, the analysis, what's it going to do for strategy, what about risk? So it's a broad business-based understanding. Communications, you have to be somebody who's good with communications. You know, there's a broad spectrum that we're required to do these days, not just internal and external with the investors. You have governments, you have regulators. So you have to be somebody who's able to articulate the strategy, the message, the business to a whole broad range of people at different levels. You have to be somebody who has relationship building skills. So building the very strong relationships across your executive team, your peers, with the board and with your own team and within finance is very important. And lastly, somebody who is going to develop a finance team, a strong finance team with all those skills that we just talked about, somebody who's got the capability to make sure they've got a range of successors within their organization.
I added in the little definition about table stakes because I think this is what caught my attention the most. It's table stakes that you understand and are competent in reporting, controls, accounting, treasury, and operations. That just gets you to the table. Wow, that says a lot in my mind. You mean to tell me I spent all those years getting a business degree, a master's degree, and have two professional accounting designations, and all those equate to just table stakes? Think about that for a moment and reflect on your own academic background. It doesn't diminish its importance, it's just assumed. And for many of us, all that technical knowledge still scares the crap out of us and will always form some portion of our professional development. But to put this in context, if you're the CFO, it's just assumed that you're maintaining this competency in the background. Instead, if you want to get ahead and distinguish yourself as the modern CFO, you need to actively consider the sorts of skill Mr. Cowan raised in the second part of his response. These are the truly intangible qualities that make some CFOs great in their role. So immediately, I had four items on my list: business acumen, communication, relationship building, and team building. But this just made me curious. Was it only these four, or were there other non-technical skills that really mattered? So I began digging deeper. And the more I dug, the deeper I got. I originally proposed the idea to Proformative Conference organizers to call this session 101 Ideas on Distinguishing Financial Executives. Because it turns out there's a rather large body of thought leadership on this matter. But I was politely reminded that this is only a 40-minute session. All this research has led me to conceptualize a bit of a chasm between our technical professional skills on one side and our executive leadership skills on the other. I started coming across various quotes identifying this transition in skill set between professional and executive. And I don't think it's something that you immediately wake up one day possessing. But the further you get along in your career, the more you'll notice the transition. And if you want to accelerate your career path with the office of the CFO in mind, then it helps to have a greater awareness of your blind spots. Let's see if we can define what this so-called chasm is by looking at a few studies. Now, throughout the presentation today, we're going to play a little game of Family Feud, and you can play along as well. So let's get started. The top six answers are on the board, and 148 senior executives were surveyed. Name a non-technical skill which is important for any CFO to drive success. Okay, you're thinking about that? The answer, let's see what the answers were. The number one answer was leadership skills, strategic capabilities, communication skills, big picture perspective, industry knowledge, and change management skills. So we can now use these survey results to generate a better understanding of the skills that define our starting point as a financial professional and our destination as a financial executive, as well as the sort of skills that will allow us to cross the bridge that takes us from being a CFO that delivers financial reporting integrity to a CFO that becomes a strategic advisor to the CEO, the rest of the executive, and the board of directors. So the purpose of today's presentation is to identify and discuss the top non-technical skills that CFOs today need to develop and demonstrate to successfully cross the soft skills chasm. So in this session, I want to share with you some of the thought leadership on the role of the modern CFO. Then, let's identify the top 10 skills that are going to differentiate you from your peers and help you evolve into an executive CFO role. And finally, let's take a few moments to highlight which of these skills need the most development and consider some ideas for furthering your own skills in these areas. Let's begin with one of the first CFO studies to come out, and it's been around now for a while, and this was provided by Deloitte, who broke out the modern CFO role into four categories: the steward role, the operator, the catalyst, and the strategist. I like this depiction, and apparently so too did some researchers at Queen's University. Using the Deloitte study as a foundation, they set out on a quest to develop a competency map for the role of the CFO by conducting additional research. The links to the competency map study is at the bottom of the slide or can be found on my website. For those of you unfamiliar with competency maps, a competency is a definition of what you can do, which includes both what you know as well as an ability to apply it. The benefit of a competency map is that once defined, you now have a benchmark against which you can self-assess your own level of proficiency. The steward role competencies include the traditional areas, including reporting and controls and information management. The operator role competencies pertain to the people management and the efficient execution of the business of finance. The catalyst role competencies pick up a number of our soft skills around influence and relationship building and change management. And the strategist role competencies are forward-looking and strategic in their orientation. The challenge identified with many of these studies is that most CFOs spend a disproportionate amount of time working in the steward and operator roles and end up inadvertently, or in some cases intentionally, shorting the catalyst and the strategist roles. Now, I say inadvertently because, let's face it, these are skills that are not as well emphasized earlier in our careers. Our early career is consumed with just wrapping our minds around the vast bodies of knowledge over which we have primary finance responsibility. But consistently, the studies show an awareness that this emphasis on the traditional back office function needs to be balanced better with other business leadership roles for the modern CFO to be successful in the future. These models give us a good lay of the land, a topographical view, if you will, of all the areas in which the CFO role holds accountability today and in the future. But it doesn't sequence the development or the expression of each of these roles. Another study by FEI tried to articulate this progression from a CFO who counts the money and controls the purse strings to a CFO who becomes the strategic advisor. FEI referred to this model as the CFO trust pyramid, and it's intended to reflect an evolution, a path, a progression of the CFO. At the understanding level, the CFO starts by developing a strong understanding of the organization, putting in place a strong finance team, and being vigilant about the business. And once established, the CFO has the opportunity to move into the second level of trust. At the second level, the CFO acts as a facilitator for change and growth across the entire organization. The CFO has the ability to coach the various business units to help them succeed, which leads them to the highest level of trust. And at the leadership level, the CFO becomes the strategic partner and a catalyst for fulfilling the vision of the organization. Now, at the lower levels of the pyramid, role clarity is easier to define, as this is largely the traditional back office function. But the role of the CFO becomes more intangible as the contribution escalates to the higher leadership levels. Note that as the CFO achieves this higher level of trust, it's natural to expect their level of influence to increase as well. I call this the quiet revolution of the finance department's evil master plan, because while we aren't necessarily responsible for making the final decisions, which rests often with the CEO or the board of directors, there's no role better situated in an organization than that of the CFO for influencing the strategic direction. So, after reading all these different research studies, I felt I was in a pretty good position to start compiling a top 10 list of the skills that are beyond the table stakes. Number one on my list, as it was on Mr. Cohen's, is business acumen. You can't add value to information, you can't interpret trends, you can't contribute, let alone lead a strategic discussion without a strong understanding of the business fundamentals. Now, I was acting as a consultant to the board of one company I was working with. Now, this was a great company steeped in history and achieving strong sales. The problem was it wasn't making any bottom line money. I was tasked to develop and deliver a turnaround strategy for the board of directors. I spent months meeting with everyone in every department learning the business to create a list of turnaround ideas. It turned out to be a rather long list of 101 items. Based on this cross-functional assessment, the board appointed me as CFO, which is the short story of how I got my first CFO appointment. Let's take a listen to this clip about how one CFO immersed himself in the business.
Yep. Well, I wouldn't recommend this for everybody, but what I did was I had told the people I reported to, you know, my first 20 years were on the TV side. So while I was CFO, I would talk to the various presidents and general managers I had. And I said, look, I'm willing to do my day job at night in order to attend wide-ranging meetings during the day. And I was very, very fortunate because at the appropriate time when I was probably ready experientially to become a president and general manager myself, I had a very special general manager who was very willing to do that. And so I did that. I attended all the news meetings, program meetings, sales meetings, essentially acting as, I guess you'd say, the unnamed COO. And, you know, as you know, if you're a CFO, if you know, with any luck at all, you're at the seat right to the leader's left or right, and you know, I earned that seat, and I did that, and I, as I said, I spent a lot of evenings doing my day job, and I found it very satisfying. It's not for everybody, but I think that was from a logistical and effort standpoint, that was the key to that success.
Learning the business requires you to spend most of your days outside of your own department and your own office. It requires you to ask a ridiculous number of questions and take a genuine interest in how other parts of the business work. Number two on our top 10 list was widely identified in virtually every study I was able to find: communication skills. And in my mind, this includes both written and oral communication skills. Though sometimes presentation skills are thought of as a standalone skill, and I couldn't agree more. You can't circulate financial information without some sort of commentary and expect people to reach similar conclusions. This is where a strong CFO can differentiate themselves. Can you take the ridiculously arcane complexity of modern finance and put it into language that tells a story that any audience can understand, either in writing or in a few slides? Number three on Mr. Cohen's list was relationship building. Relationship building is broadly applicable as far as finance stretches, which is pretty much every department and business unit in the organization, as well as to the board of directors and the broader external community. The most important relationship you need to develop is with the CEO. The trust pyramid we looked at earlier establishes the prerequisites for developing a high trust relationship. But the CFO also needs to develop strong allies across the executive team. They will need to develop a relationship with their own team members as well, which is typically the easiest and most necessary to achieve, without which they won't have time to move beyond their back office responsibilities. And of course, developing relationships outside the organizations with peers, lenders, investors, and others is equally important. Relationships are fundamentally built on trust. Ken Blanchard wrote a short book, which I read while sitting in the plaza at Notre Dame, entitled Trust Works. He boiled trust down into four necessary ingredients that he called the ABCD trust model. A is for able. That is, you must be able to help your employees, the CEO, or other executives with your knowledge, experience, or your insights. In other words, you're competent within your domain. B is for believable, which means that you must be honest, sincere, and maintain personal confidences. C is for connected, which means that you listen well, you show an interest, and you work well with others. D is for dependable, which means that you're timely, responsive, organized, and accountable. Now, this stuff may not seem like rocket science, but I'm going to challenge you to open up your list of contacts on your smartphone or whatever. Identify the key people with whom you want or need to have a relationship, be they for personal or professional reasons. And ask yourself whether you are demonstrating each of the ABCD traits on a regular basis with this individual. I suspect you've got some room for improvement. Which rolls right into number 4 in our top 10 list, team building skills. The only way you're going to successfully spend more time acting as a strategic advisor is to develop a capable team to support you. A capable team relieves you of some of the stewardship and operator responsibilities. This requires you to recruit, retain, develop, and motivate a team of highly competent and committed professionals. One tool that I've used successfully in each of my own CFO roles is to plan, recruit, and develop my finance team using a competency map of the entire finance function. I sat back and reflected on the mandate of the finance function and then determined the required competencies for my team to be successful within the broader context of the mission of the organization. I then took those various competencies and allocated them to different employee roles, which became job descriptions. Then you can assess and develop existing employees or recruit new employees to fill in those roles. Finally, the competency map is a useful tool for facilitating a discussion of professional development, career planning, succession planning for each person on your team. Number 5 on our list of the top 10, I'm going to call executive presence and influence. How's that for being touchy-feely? It's one of those qualities, you know it to see it, but it's more difficult to describe. But how are you and your ideas perceived by your peers and by the CEO? Do you have the ear of the CEO? There's no greater compliment than having a CEO who uses your words or comes to you for advice to communicate the status of something to the board or an investor group. That's just one simple indication that someone is listening to you and that your say holds sway. If you don't have the sort of influence in your organization yet, consider some of the barriers confronting you. Let's get back to what's really important. And of course, that's the game. The top 6 answers are on the board. In a survey of 148 senior executives, identify a barrier a CFO might face in achieving influence. Give it a moment's thought. The number one barrier identified by the survey was company culture, followed by no finance integration with the rest of the business, followed by an organizational structure that was very siloed, followed by a controlling CEO, followed by a lack of understanding of the skills of the CFO, and finally, a lack of credibility beyond finance. Number 6 on the top 10 list is to become a facilitator and business partner. I think the CFO needs to be someone who helps managers do their job of running the existing business better, whether it's through providing analytic support or helping with structuring different sales deals. Every good executive should realize value from having a good CFO strapped to their side when it comes to managing the business. The CFO brings to the table a few key perspectives that help the manager. First, the CFO brings an objective perspective. Secondly, the CFO brings a broader cross-functional perspective. And third, the CFO brings a financial perspective. Number 7 on my top 10 list of soft skills is the ability to innovate. Now, admittedly, this is a bit of a stretch on first blush, but I think this skill goes well with both the catalyst and the strategist roles. Innovation is a mindset. It's not limited to simply developing new products and services. It's a continuous thinking about ways to do things better. Now, I've included the second quote as just one example of how adopting, say, a new technology might be considered an innovative approach in finance. I think it's important to open our minds as to what truly constitutes innovation. In another FEI study, executives were asked to identify what innovation looks like in their organization. And interestingly, the top two responses were focused on making small incremental improvements at both a process and personal level. Then the remainder of the list focuses on what most typically attribute to innovation. I think a CFO who can demonstrate and point to examples of how they've been innovative can add a tremendous amount of value to prospective CEO or a board of directors. Number 8 on the top 10 list is the strategic capabilities. Overall, the CEOs most frequently turn to the CFO for strategic planning advice, simply because the CFO is the best positioned to consider the full implications of strategy across the organization. But the challenge for many CFOs is expanding that perspective from a backward-looking assessment to also now include a forward-looking view as well. An EY study looked at the areas where a CFO is playing a leading role in the development of corporate strategy. And the top 5 areas included, first, providing insight and analysis to support the strategic planning initiative. Secondly, leading key initiatives in finance, as one might expect. Thirdly, ensuring that business decisions are grounded in sound financial criteria. Fourthly, the funding aspect and enabling and executing of the strategy, which has been set by the CEO. And then finally, interestingly, 35% of the respondents are playing a leading role in developing and defining the overall strategy for the organization. Number 9 on our top 10 list is change management skills. For anyone who has been through a significant change initiative, perhaps implementing a new ERP or integrating a merger, you'll recognize that the success or failure was largely determined by how people were managed during transition. Change management pundits will commonly throw around statistics like 70% of change management initiatives fail to achieve the objectives established at the outset. That's a pretty daunting statistic to overcome. But I'm going to offer some hope. A little bit of awareness of change management principles can make a huge difference in the outcome of your initiative. One change management study illustrates that when effectively considered and incorporated into the design, the project's objectives are largely met and mostly go according to schedule. When change management is ineffectively considered, you can see that the objectives and the schedule are rarely met. Number 10 on the top 10 list is credible leader. As we saw earlier, a lack of credibility was a barrier to achieving influence. In fact, in a study of what makes for a credible leader, it turns out that there are 4 qualities that keep percolating to the top. Credible leaders are honest, forward-looking, competent, and inspirational. There's so much that can be said about leadership, but I think it all boils down to being authentic, adapting your style to the situation, and taking a keen interest in the personal development of your people and the organization for the long term. So there you have a list of 10 soft skills that will differentiate you as a CFO. But what else? What else should be on this list of skills that differentiates the great CFOs? Things that were close that didn't quite make my list included an ability to raise funds, an ability to negotiate, courage, persistence, a sense of humor. What other things do you think should be on that list? Which leaves us with one final question to answer, and that is to discuss approaches to developing these various skills. Now, I will say there's a tremendous amount of freely available resources out there for you to access, as I just demonstrated over the last 30 minutes. However, for every good resource, there's a dozen poor resources. So developing these skills on the cheap is a time-consuming endeavor, but not impossible. I really believe that it's a mix of formal training with on-the-job experimentation that is the best way to develop your soft skills. Conferences such as this one and the resources available at the Proformative Academy are wonderful ways to plan and document your own development. Let's move on to the bonus round of our Family Feud Challenge. Point values are doubled. The top 8 answers are on the board. 669 senior financial executives were surveyed and asked which skills they needed to develop the most. Give it some thought. Are you ready? The number one answer was communication skills by 32% of the respondents, followed by influencing skills, relationship building skills, presentation skills, business acumen, change management, project management, strategic capabilities, and people management skills. Reflection is an important activity to allow these ideas to formulate further in your own mind. To help you with this activity, I'm going to provide you with a CFO self-assessment tool that you can use to evaluate your own areas of strengths and weaknesses using that Queen's University CFO competency map that we discussed earlier as your benchmark. So, read the competency and the description and decide for yourself your own level of proficiency. The tool gives you some ideas on how you can develop competency and allows you to document your own professional development plan. Many of you here today are existing CFOs, and perhaps the question posed, what does it take to get hired, doesn't hold as much relevance for you. But hopefully you've come away with a few insights about what leading CFOs are thinking and doing. To fulfill the type of CFO profile we discussed here today, here's three action items for you to consider. First, build a strong finance team around you. To be that catalyst strategist CFO, you need a team that you can trust to deal with the financial reporting and business processing aspects of the finance function. Secondly, spend more time with customers and those in operations to build stronger relationships and enhance your own understanding of the business. And finally, if you've done those first two action items, then you should be well positioned to partner with business unit leaders and the CEO in developing business and corporate strategy. Let's close today's comments with one last quote that I think encapsulates once and for all the question about what the CEO and the board are looking for in the CFO they hire today. A great CFO is an integral part of creating a world-class management team that can make or break a business. A great CFO must be a great strategic thinker, a strong manager, and have strong business sense and excellent financial skills. A CFO's ability to put numbers in a business context is an absolutely essential part of what every business needs to be successful. So, within the handouts, I've included some bonus materials. 101 ideas to differentiate yourself as CFO. I couldn't resist.